Hi everyone, I'm Ankita from NASSCOM. I hope all of you are doing great and learning something new, relevant courses you're taking up to upskill yourself. Today's session holds a lot of importance because it will be conducted by one of our mentees from the NASSCOM's Deep Tech Club. It is a mentor-mentee program for early stage product companies, startups working in deeper technologies managed by NASSCOM's Product Council. For more information, please visit our microsite. I'll share the URL over the chat window. Moving back to the session, today Sonal Goyal, founder of Moog Technologies, will share her knowledge on agile master data management at scale with AI. Questions can be asked anytime during the session, but would be answered at the end when Sonal finishes her presentation. Also, after the session, please provide me your feedback to help me improve my future webinars. Welcome, Sonal, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Ankita. Thank you for this warm introduction. And I hope the audience today will enjoy the session on Agile Master Data Management at Scale with AI. You've already done the introductions, but just to break the ice, I am the founder of Nube Technologies, and we are building an Agile MDM platform using AI. And I will cover some of the use cases and some of the applications of AI technology today. In my past avatar, before founding Nube, I was working with various companies in telecom, investment banking, travel and insurance. And that's where the idea of a master data management system came into place. I am a repeat speaker in Spark Summit, Strata, Gates, and other leading international data and AI conferences. I'm also on the program committee for O'Reilly Strata Data and AI. So I hope today the session would, although it's like a 2:30 p.m. Post-lunch session, but I hope there would be some key takeaways for the attendees, and they would enjoy the MDM journey using AI and learn how to apply AI in their day-to-day master data management. So today I am going to talk about the background for an MDM system. What is an MDM? How does it benefit a company? I will cover issues with traditional rule-based MDM systems. I will identify some problem areas where AI can be applied, and also talk about some approaches on how that application of AI can be done at scale. So let's talk about the usual way in which data is stored and managed in an organization. Now, as a company grows, so do its data systems. And to take care of a business line or to manage a product or to handle a new territory, a team of people are working together in a company. Now, this team needs specific tools to save and manipulate their data. So for an example, they may prefer a homegrown CRM instead of a corporate sales force, or they may just be using a spreadsheet, which is more comfortable for them to use and to share around. For this specific product line, they'll probably build up a few custom applications. Their supply chain systems may also be different from that of the headquarters. And they may also, they may have some specialized systems, but they also be using the corporate tools and systems as advocated. So it will be a mix and a match. And all this is like perfectly okay. I mean, we talk about data silos and they're bad, but this is perfectly fine. These tools are needed to get the job done. These data silos are essential. They are essential for operational efficiency. The teams need to comply with local regulations. They have to cater to the audience and deliver results. So having their own data under their control empowers them to act fast and respond quickly to growing business needs. The teams can represent entities the way it makes most sense to them. They may not probably care about address field, let's say, in some cases, or they may be very particular about the validity of the email field in some cases. So they can actually choose as they go along, and they can use internal IT or contracted engineers, most likely a combination of both, help them to run and manage these systems. So over time, what also happens is that large companies work with other larger companies or smaller companies and partners. They acquire or merge, adding more mix of data to their already growing data systems. Now, what people, so these data silos are good. I mean, they help the business run effectively. But then what people also realize is that they can deliver even further value from the data when they can combine these unit-specific data systems or data silos. So let's take the case of customer data, for example. Like, we can join and merge customer data across product lines and learn buyer propensity. We can discover opportunities to cross-sell and upsell. We can build personalized communication and targeted channels. Companies can onboard customers faster and more effectively in a more accurate way when the customer data is actually combined and unified. So just joining and, you know, unifying this customer data, we can increase the sales effectiveness, delight the customer. We can deliver products and services the way the customer wants through the channels that they prefer, simply by knowing more about them. And in the same vein, we can also manage risk and compliance. Understand, so let's, you know, in the case of, let's say, insurance, we can understand how much risk we are associated with a customer or a household. Or say which systems house customer data for GDPR subject access request, which is a growing problem for organizations these days. Similarly for vendors, I mean, although customer data is typically one of the biggest reasons why MDM systems are in place, but vendor data consolidation across data silos also yields terrific insights about vendor outlay across business units, regions, and geographies. Companies can understand pricing consistencies across divisions, onboard new suppliers faster, and manage risk associated with vendor location and labor practices. I guess something that, you know, you will understand more and probably feel more, especially in the times of COVID, when understanding the supply chain and understanding the vendor location has become critical to managing the supply chain for an organization. So similarly, in the same way, integrating other data assets like supplies can help share supplies across divisions, or figure out the best supplier for a given supply, or drive pricing consistency across business units. So those are some overlooked areas or some broad areas, but those are the reasons that an MDM typically adds value to an organization. So there is tremendous value in integrating these data silos. I mean, MDM is a practice that has been, you know, been there for a long duration, and traditionally been applied only by very large corporates, but now more and more companies are looking at this value. So here what we're saying is, when you're looking at implementing an MDM, we are not breaking these data silos. We want them to stay. We want them to remain as functional as they are, as agile as they are. We want the business to continue to function the way it is functioning. But so we let the respective teams, you know, manage them and own them and continue to drive the business as performant way as they have already been doing. But when we're unifying, what we're trying to say is that we are looking at the overall picture. We are augmenting our focused view with a holistic organizational view. And then what we can do is we can supercharge our already smart teams with the insights we gather from this unified and integrated data. These teams can now consume the information from the MDM. So instead of just being suppliers to the MDM, they can actually be consumers to the information flowing from the MDM, from all this unified data, and operate more effectively, save costs, reduce risks, and so in effect, using an MDM, we are using the collective wisdom in each of the silos and making an informed choice over trusted data. So to recap, the MDM benefits, I mean, which business doesn't want to, you know, increase their revenues or to reduce their costs, reduce their risks, and to stay compliant. And those are the foundational pieces over which a business runs. And that's why having an MDM strategy and having an agile MDM practice is critical to business and its operations. Now, how does an MDM system work, right? We've talked about all this unification. We've talked about all this data integration for customers or for suppliers or for parts. So how does it really work? What are the features that a typical MDM system provides to us? So to build this, you know, unified view, an MDM system, in fact, it will talk to all these data silos. It will probably do a JDBC request, get the data out, or there would be an ETL process governed through the MDM system. And the data would be together, brought together in a place through which it can be processed. Then the MDM will help the business to piece this together as an entity. So, you know, let's say your customer is spread across multiple systems. And then you say that a customer is defined as a combination of attributes like first name, last name, email, phone number, organization name, address attributes. So typically whatever is valuable to know about the customer is how you would define your entity. And once this definition is made, the attributes from different silos are mapped to this entity. So let's say, you know, there is a system where it's pretty straightforward. Like you're saying that, you know, last name from this data silo one corresponds to last name attribute of my customer in the MDM system. In some cases, the field names would be different. So you can say last underscore name from my one source system actually maps to last name column in my MDM system. In some cases, we may actually need to do some, you know, preparation or transformation, which is also helped by the MDM, where you want to concatenate two fields. You want to concatenate, let's say, first name and last name, and together have a complete customer name. So all this is, you know, provided as a feature by the MDM. Sometimes we also need to clean out some records which contain erroneous values. So like NA or blanks or 1900 for birth year. So we want to do some cleansing or standardization prior to, you know, unifying this data, because we want our output to be, you know, not wrong. We don't want it to be corrupted. Now, once this is done, so we've aligned the schema, we know what columns from our source systems are to be integrated into the final master entity. The MDM system needs to group the data of an entity from different silos together. Now, humans will enter, you know, data in different ways, right? They will, many of the records may have, you know, been humanly entered, or they would come from partners or suppliers or from other systems. Or sometimes the customer may have supplied those values. So there will be a lot of variations in the terms of typos or salutations. There can be multiple languages. There can be so many abbreviations that you're dealing with. So an MDM system will allow you to, you know, define how do you match or group these records together to represent one customer or one product or one vendor. Now, these rules are typically handcrafted by a collaboration of IT and business, and then they're regularly tweaked to avoid the hits and misses. And you build some rules, then you try to converge, and then you look at your data and you again work on that. And once we've got, you know, all records associated with a customer or a vendor together, we also want to build a golden record. So in MDM systems, what we call is a golden record, which is essentially that, you know, we pick up a representative set of attributes across the source systems which contributed to the group. So we say that, you know, we could trust one source system like the CRM mode, let's say, for email data. Then we can say that, you know, I want to only pick up the email from my Salesforce. But we are, let's say, more confident of the address in the application database. So we want to pick up the address attributes from the application database. We also want to make sure that if a system has been updated only recently we are more confident about and we would trust it more. So there are some, you know, logic that goes into building this golden record. And all this is kind of, you know, facilitated by the MDM system. Now, the golden record can also be exposed back to the data silos, and they may use it to enrich back their source and gather more information about their data. Now, another thing that the MDM system helps with is, you know, to look at hierarchies. I mean, how is the data really arranged? Some hierarchical data may be like very organization specific, like who reports to who. And so typical those kind of hierarchies or lines of control. But in some other cases, there will be, you know, especially for parts or for services and supplies, there are some taxonomies like the UNSPSC or the E-class, which define categories that they that the supplies or the services belong to. And then most large organizations also have their own internal taxonomies or classification schemes. And a lot of times, actually, they have, you know, more than one taxonomy or classification scheme. So they will try to classify their records, local versus global, and various kinds of supplies, which head do they go to, so that they can have a better view. So in fact, a custom or a standard MDM, whether it's a custom or a standard hierarchy, so the MDM system will allow us to, you know, define these hierarchies and assign records to it. And then we can, this helps us to understand the relationships and club together those different records. Now, so if we look at, you know, the current MDM technology and what it does, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, manipulation of the data. There's a lot of looking at the data and deriving appropriate groupings or a classification out of it. And traditionally, how this has been done is that, you know, it's like the traditional wisdom of data engineering, which is like inspired by programming. So you say, like, it's like a rule-based system, right? You say, if this condition meets, then this, else this. So you try to cover all conditions, you try to create a lot of rules around matching, around hierarchies, and you define the rules. Sometimes you also get to choose what algorithms you want to, you know, like in the case of matching, you want to run the match on. And that's where you can actually make sense of your data. But I mean, this rule-based system probably was okay if, you know, you had smaller data, if you had less variety of data to look at. But what we see is that, you know, a typical MDM system, it's essentially a scale problem, because this, like as I mentioned, right, you're looking at supplies, you're looking at vendors, you're looking at employees, you're looking at products, you're looking at customers, you're looking at partners and resellers. So there can be so many different ways on different entities over which you want to master. So there is this whole variety of mastered entities. So when I'm talking about scale here, I'm not really saying, so scale here is just not, you know, just the sheer number of records. Sheer number of records definitely is a problem, but also the variety of, you know, the mastering that you want to do and the kind of activities that we want to do in terms of grouping them, in terms of merging them for a golden record, in terms of classifying them. So there is this whole scale problem that comes into play where traditional systems tend to fail. Now, in terms of MDM scale, as I mentioned, this variety of you know, types of mastering that you want to do. So you have, let's say, one company that we are working with, they have 80 different vendor systems. And it takes them anywhere from, you know, 3 weeks to a few months to verify and onboard a single new vendor. Now imagine, I mean, how much operational, you know, cost this is, you know, how much of a business cost it is if they want to procure from this vendor and it takes them a few months just to onboard the new vendor. Similarly, in terms of scale, like, you know, a life sciences company wrote with data, 6 million healthcare provider records spread across different silos. Even like this example of nonprofit that I've put in here, It has a network of 3 million donors. I mean, it's a small charity. It's not even a very, very big charity. It's a small charitable organization working with a specific group of people. And then they have, you know, custom application databases. So just to tell you, I mean, just as example of the kind of MDM scale that an everyday MDM system kind of deals with. Sorry, is there a... So in terms of, you know, if you look at your classic system where we are doing this through rules, where we are doing this if-then-else condition, we see that this becomes very unstable, right, pretty soon. And like companies that do initiate, you know, an MDM journey, they will take a couple of years to master their one or two major domains. Like they'll do their customer master and then they'll drop off, because the engineering effort and the maintenance costs are typically very high. Just to quote some statistics from you know, the industry, on the whole, the people costs of a typical rule-based MDM project are 4 times that of the license cost. And that essentially means that even when you want to master a lot of the domains and deal with more and more sources and look at more and more variations, you're not really able to do so, because the rule-based system is not going to scale. So one problem, which is again very close to my heart and something that we've really worked a lot on. Now, this is like data matching within an MDM system. And this is a bit different from, you know, the other kind of scale problems that I had been discussing. So when we, so other kind of like the scale problems, right, we're just looking at a single record. But here, when we are, you know, looking at a matching a record, we essentially have to record against every other record in the system. And then, like if you have, let's say you just have 1 million records and you have 10 attributes. So for that one single attribute, you are looking at 1 million, you have to make 1 million comparisons. And if you look at all the attributes, it's essentially for 1 million records, the matching exercise is a 10 trillion comparisons. And although, I mean, the rule-based systems also, there are, you know, approaches where you specify a rule, where you don't compare everything with everything, you block, you specify a block key. But still, I mean, most MDM systems suffer terribly at scale here. If they have to scale to 10 million records or 15 million records, it just starts, you know, killing those rules here. So like with all these problems, and like, so what with this importance of MDM and with all these problems, like, is it possible that, you know, we can use AI on some of the problems that we are seeing in MDM? Can we get it to, can we apply it to more and more domains? Can we handle the variety of the data that we're seeing? Can we look at scaling it to millions of records at ease with very little human effort? So let's say, like, you know, we look at, when we look at, hear about AI, we say that, you know, we need AI, and AI which can, you know, kind of learn from the data. And you can train a model on some data, you have some labels, and then you can apply the model on new records, and, you know, you get the prediction. So typically that's the way an AI system works. Now, how do we really apply AI to this MDM system? So let's get some training data, as I mentioned, right? We learn from some samples, data for when I say training data, essentially data for which the results are already known. So we can tell the system that this is the data, these are the results. Now, can you go and understand what is the result to be derived for the new set of data? Now, So training data in the case of an MBM system would typically be, right, like which records belong to the same vendor, or which record is a stationary spend, which records actually refer to the same customer. Then once we have some training data, we can build the representations from that data. Now, this is called feature engineering. There's a lot of discussion around it these days. So let's say, you know, in the case of, let's say, matching. So we have a pair of records which are matching. Now, one feature can be the number of characters that are common. Or for spend classification, the case that I mentioned, it can be the word vectors of the supplies. So essentially, a feature will take the textual data, convert it into a vector or which the model can consume. And then we kind of build a model that fits the data. So a model that can make reasonable predictions on the data. It can be like a clustering data which groups things together. It can be a classification model which says that, you know, this record belongs to this category. And given the features, it can tell us which bucket the record actually goes to. So eventually, I mean, this AI exercise is also a bit iterative. We build some training data, we build a model, we look at the results. Eventually, when we're happy with the model performance, when we know that the predictions are kind of in line with, you know, they're accurate, they are kind of in line with what we are looking for, we can productionize this. So we can build a data pipeline which has all these steps in an automated way, which derives the features from the raw data and applies the model, and it gets the prediction. So the good part here is that, you know, if we've done a good job in choosing our AI model and building our features, we don't need a representative sample for each variation in the data. So the typical problem with a rule-based system is that if your data doesn't match a rule, it will fall through the cracks. It will not have a result that you want, or the system will not be able to handle it. Typical AI systems generalize from the samples. And that's where, I mean, that's where the beauty of AI kind of comes into play. That AI shines where rules fail, because it can generalize. And in some cases, it will overgeneralize, or it will be very biased towards your training data, towards the kind of data you have in the training. It may not generalize. So those are some pitfalls that are there, but there are techniques that, you know, you can do to take care of the bias or to the overgeneralization. So as I was mentioning that AI is not a silver bullet. Like, we have to make sure that the problem we are trying to solve is really an AI problem. Like organizational hierarchy. Like, is it really an AI problem? Like we have a person, John Doe, who's working and who reports to Mary Ann. But that doesn't imply that, you know, every John that we have in the organization has to report to Mary Ann. So there's no way we can actually, you know, codify this information or, you know, build a model out of it. So these kind of organizational knowledge, where you trust this particular system more, or something which cannot be codified, I mean, that definitely is not an AI problem. So that kind of problem we cannot solve through AI. But there are problems which are painful and large enough, which we can justify our effort and cost, which come to us, where the data changes, where we are doing so much rules and algorithms, and we don't want to, you know, manage those weights, and we want the system to be able to build that. So those are the things, those are the problems where, you know, we can apply AI on. Now, we also, when we want to apply AI, we also have to see, like, you know, do we have training data? Are there enough samples for us to learn from? And then also, as a company which is doing its business, do we really want to manage a production AI? Or do we think that, you know, the way we are going is okay and we can manage without that? So those are some thoughts that, you know, we should probably consider when applying AI. And then when we talk about, you know, so we've kind of like, let's say we've decided that, you know, there are some problems that we feel we could apply AI on. So then what are the ways in which we can actually build that AI? So, right, so like we need the training data to build that AI engine. And then one is obviously like, if you're lucky, if you had some training data from the past lying around, you have some previous efforts, your rule-based system has produced something, you could leverage that. In many cases, that is not possible. And so there are some cases where, you know, you've never applied a data mastering or a data classification, and you don't have any training data. So what do you do then? So what we can do is, like, you know, we can use machine learning techniques and build training data. So we can learn from the user feedback from a technique called active learning. Now, what active learning does is it picks up samples of data from the pool, and then it asks a human to label it. Now, what that helps with is that the human effort in labeling the data is minimized because it picks out very representative cases. And then we can quickly, you know, bootstrap the training data and build up our training data pretty fast. Also, like, if you've set up active learning, so an engineer can set up active learning, and then a human expert or a business expert can actually provide the labels. So it's kind of a good collaboration between both the teams to understand what they're trying to get at. And active learning can also be frugal, right? So you can actually make sure that you're picking out very smart representative samples. And so you don't have to, you know, try to pick out every edge case. You pick out representative samples through active learning, and you can integrate millions of records. So just as a study we did recently, we were able to do 15 million customer records using roughly 400 to 500 samples of matches provided by a business user. So let's say, I mean, active learning is one case. Then we look at weak supervision. Weak supervision, where we also use that technique to build up some training data. Now, this is weak supervision is something which is very hotly researched, you know, these days in the machine learning and the AI community, where what you do is that, you know, you write some functions or rules programmatically. So a weak supervision is actually done by a data engineer or a data scientist. And you define some loose functions for rules. So say that, you know, whenever the text contains printer, we say that this has to be classified as a printing supply. Now, what's the beauty here, right? You're again writing rules. But the thing is that these rules are very broad. They don't need to be accurate. So you can actually write up, you know, a whole lot of functions, and the weak supervision system will be able to take these noisy, you know, samples and build out a very fairly accurate model out of it. So, like, even when these, you know, these training functions are actually not 100% accurate, the generated labels are going to be noisy. So in many cases, right, even when I have used the printer term in a product supply, but the label may be wrong. So which we call as like a noisy label. So even then, what happens is that it looks at the strength of the other functions. So you've given, let's say, 10 functions, 8 are pointing for it to be a printer, 2 are pointing for it to be, let's say, a toner. So what the system can do is, even if those functions in totality are not giving a code, you know, the exact same label, but it can match and merge those labels and figure out how to cancel or attach weights to these functions, so that, you know, it knows what to do. It knows what is the right label to attach. And then you can actually build up a lot of training data like that. So there are libraries like Snorkel, which is from Stanford, and which uses weak supervision which has a lot of samples you can refer to for clustering and classification to quickly bootstrap training data and to build up clustering and classification use cases. So I mentioned, right, that there are some, while applying AI to an MDM system or to any system, we have to choose very wisely. We have to make sure that the problem is worthy enough, it is large enough, there is representative data, and we have the expertise and the skills to manage it. So some fields where, you know, MDM, some fields, some features of MDM or some places in an MDM system where AI can be applied, given that broad definition, is schema integration, data matching, which is also called deduplication or entity consolidation, product and supplies classification, and then just overall improving data quality. So you can have, you know, like suggestions on which attributes can really help with a lot of data integration effort, right? So see, schema integration is like a very common problem that even without an MDM, people are going to face whenever they are matching and merging records, building a data warehouse or a data lake. Now, by definition of a mapping, you actually have a multiple system, you actually have multiple systems which are which you need to map. So let's say, you know, the system, AI system, can actually learn from user feedback. So you can generate training data by learning from the mappings of one source system. And then you can actually save a lot of headache and over time, you know, learn what is the best column mapping for a new incoming column and a new incoming source system. Now, data matching, again, a very core MDM capability, and something which a traditional rule-based system doesn't do very well. So you have lots of data stewards, right, working through the false positives that the MDM system is churning out, crafting so many rules, tweaking the weights. So that is one place where AI can actually fit very nicely into. It's also very, very problematic scale problem. Then product and supplies classification, which is a very typical use case of AI classification. And then improving the data quality, which is one of the reasons then the MDM system is also used, where you can, you know, you do anomaly and pattern detection and use it for data quality. So let's look at, you know, schema integration, like, right? So one could build, you know, feature vectors from columns, and you can cluster similar columns together. So let's say for, you know, a text-based column, what can we do? How do we build those features? So we have word vectors, we can have paragraph vectors. So we can scan the column, we can look at, we can create word vectors, we can build paragraph vectors, we can build most frequent words. We can look at the rare words and codify them. We can look at the number of characters per record. And so these will be like, you know, standard for a string column. Those can be some of the features that we use. And based on that, we can cluster similar columns together. So typically, you know, address column will have more incidents of street, of avenue, of road, of flat, and those kind of words together. So if we cluster them across different source systems, we know that all those columns actually are referring to the address column. Similarly, for numeric columns, we can look at the range histograms. We can look at the frequency of particular values. We can look at what are the most common values, what are the rarest values. And then we can again cluster these records, cluster these columns together. And sometimes they would be, you know, so even if we do it, there would be a human who understands the system better, or the features may not have been the most perfect ones. So then we can fine tune those feature weights by looking at user feedback. So when the user is actually, you know, mapping a column or overriding one of our mappings suggested by the system, the system can actually start learning from there. And next time a similar column comes, it can get better and recommend a better column to map to. Now, in terms of data matching, so I mentioned, right, that this is a problem which is critical to the MDM. I mean, that's the whole reason why an MDM exists, to integrate the data together from different systems. And that is one problem that we feel that, you know, can be solved very elegantly through AI. So we can use active learning to quickly bootstrap the matching rules. So instead of, you know, saying that, you know, there's a condition which says that if the first name, the edit distance between the first name columns is more than, and if the first three words of the company name are the same, then it is a likely match. So having those rules and having an order of rules, instead of saying that, we could actually, you know, use these edit distances as features. We could build a classifier which takes care of these features, and then it knows how to combine this attribute level similarity to record level similarity. So we build the features at a column level, and we build a classifier which can together combine all these features together and give us a unified score to say if there is a match or a non-match. And how do we bootstrap this? We can, again, we can, like, say we can use active learning, which picks out some representative pairs. A human expert can label them. So you build training data, and then you can tune the feature weights and the importance of the columns based on the user feedback. Now, when I talked about matching, I also, if you remember, I also said that, you know, this is a crazy scale problem. It's 10 trillion comparisons for 1 million records with 10 attributes. And now when we are computing edit distance, and you know, when we're doing these comparisons, it's actually very compute intensive, because you're looking character by character or word by word within a column. So we don't want to do these Cartesian joins. We don't want to compare everything with everything and crash our systems. So what we're doing is that when we're doing this active learning, when we're showing these samples to the user, we can also learn to cluster these likely matches. So what we say is that, you know, we know which are likely similar. They may not be really similar, but these are the clusters where it makes most sense to do the second round of finer tuned feature engineering, where it makes sense to, you know, figure out what kind of characters are matching. So instead of, you know, comparing 1 million records against 1 million records, we kind of, you know, break that into, let's say, buckets of 100,000 records or 50,000 records. And only within those 50,000 records, we actually do those edit distances or string comparisons so that we can be more effective. And that clustering we can easily actually learn through machine learning. Now, in terms of product and supplies classification, so again, what we see is that, you know, these words or phrases are most commonly associated with a category or a taxonomy, right? When it's a printer, it's in the loose text. If the supplies has printer, it's more likely to be a stationary supply. So then a combination of NLP and AI here can help classify these records. And you can actually learn. So we can build those features. Then we see exactly, like, you know, we can pick out the top three categories to which it likely looks like. And then we learn from the user feedback and tie it back to those features. So we are recently working on the UNSPSC classification, which is a standard taxonomy. And so the customer kind of was telling us that it takes a human 150 to 200 records per day to classify a supply for spend classification. And training a machine learning algorithm and to work it at scale definitely is something that can be done and can be applied multiple times again and again to new data. Similarly, for data quality, like as I was mentioning that, you know, you can extract attributes from long form products or supplies data. So you can tag it properly. You can identify. So let's say, you know, a particular data source every time is sending me 10,000 records in, on an incremental basis. But one day it just sends us 1,000 records. So probably there is, you know, an anomaly there. Or the column values, which never had a particular value, suddenly they start, if the value was between 0 to 10, suddenly the column started showing up 999. Maybe those are the things that, you know, we can start flagging and looking at. So an AI system can probably look at it, because humanly for us to go through all those combinations and to keep building those rules becomes really difficult. So all good about AI. I mean, I've talked a lot about, you know, how AI can solve all the machine learning problems, all the, sorry, MDM problems. But I think what we also need to understand is that when we are looking at AI, although it's a far more mature technology these days, but we also have to look at, you know, understanding that building a production grade AI will need expertise, and there has to be a willingness to experiment, because sometimes, I mean, the data will have patterns, definitely it will have patterns, but there will be some experiments to and fro in terms of tuning the models, in terms of, you know, getting the right features. So we have to make sure that we are ready to experiment in a small agile way, not really, you know, a full blown. So take a small problem, preferably start on one of the most painful problems that you have. We can also run into, you know, challenges while scaling, clustering and classification. So AI, very good, but to apply it effectively, I think the best approach is to start small, start with one painful problem, build up the training data, learn from that and go from there. So that is pretty much what I wanted to cover today, and I hope the presentation made sense to the audience. I would like to open up for the questions now.
Thanks, Sonal, for this wonderful presentation. So yes, we have few questions. So audience, we are now beginning the Q&A round. So please ask questions and clear your doubts. So the first question is by Bala asking, how we can scale up 10 trillion records in real and limited time using AI?
Sure, Bala. So as I mentioned, Bala, that we have to break down this problem. Data matching cannot be achieved by doing this Cartesian join and comparing everything with everything. I mean, that's a dull, right? As you've seen the scale of the problem, 1 million records comparing against 1 million records, you have 10 attributes, it blows into 10 trillion comparisons. So what we do through AI is that we don't compare everything with everything. What we do is we cluster the broad matches together. Now, so let's say, you know, we have a customer database. So let's say we cluster on country and city. So then the clustering algorithm can actually run pretty fast. And then you can actually break down those, you know, million records into buckets of, say, 50,000 or 20,000, depending on age attributes, depending on, you know, city or state or some other kind of attributes. And then only within those buckets, you actually do the finer comparisons. So that is how AI can help there.
Thanks, Sonal, for the answer. The next question is by Prashant. What volume of data will help decide when to move from rule-based to AI?
Okay, that's a great question. So
I would say apply AI only when your current system is. So you're having to make a lot. So one is just the volume of data, then is the variety of data. So there are two, three aspects that you need to take care of, right? Are you able to handle all your requirements in your data management system by using a rule-based system? Or are you spending a lot of repetitive effort cleansing up your rules, moving up your rules, figuring out your you know, your logic of applying those rules, so the order of the rules? If that is a problem, you need to take to start considering AI. Now, in terms of volumes of data, if you have 100,000 records, maybe 150K records, probably that's not the best use of AI. But if you have at least 500,000 records or so, doing it humanly with all the variations becomes a challenge. And I think that's where you can start looking at AI-based technologies.
Thanks, Sonal. Priya is asking, not sure if this question is relevant to this forum, but what are the most cost-effective AI tools?
So this could be very generic. I'm not sure what kind of tools you're talking about here. So AI tools in terms of master data management, probably rare. I can pitch in my product here. But there are a whole lot of, you know, open source libraries. If you want to get started on data science and AI, you have TensorFlow, you have PyTorch. There is no end to, you know, on a larger scale, you have distributed AI on running on Spark. So I think it will depend. So the tool, I think, will depend on the problem that you're trying to solve. But AI algorithms per se are a commodity. I mean, you can get a classifier, a random forest algorithm. You don't have to code it from scratch. That kind of tools and tooling exists pretty much very easily.
Thanks, Sonal. Jiku has a compliment as well as a question. Thanks, great presentation. Love to know more about it. Example, training. How well this integrate with other enterprise systems?
I'm sorry, I think I will have to ask some clarification on this. Thanks that you like this presentation. So what exactly, what kind of integration are you talking about in terms of training here? Because this training we are talking about is on the data which we are trying to master.
Jiku, can you please elaborate your question? Can you frame your question again, Jiku? An audience, please ask questions. We have already started the Q&A round. Okay, Jiku has clarified it. He's saying training. I would like to know how to get trained on this tool.
How to get trained? Okay. So the techniques actually I covered here are generic. They're not really tool specific. And what you can do is you can actually refer to Snorkel. S-N-O-R-K-E-L, and I can, send a link to you later if you need. So especially for weak supervision, there is a tool for, building out your weak supervision training data. For feature engineering, it's a vast field. So I think it will have to be very problem specific. But there is a whole bunch of, information on AI, on applying AI on MDM, even on our website, which you can probably just refer to if you want. And if you need, just reach out to me personally, maybe then I can help you maybe then.
There's also an added line by Chiku. He's saying also how this will be used in an enterprise.
Okay, so the enterprise is essentially building out their MDM function using AI. So what I've talked about here is that, instead of going for a rule-based MDM system, an enterprise can supercharge their MDM journey or a data management or data integration journey by leveraging AI technologies. So they can have in-house developers, or they can buy a tool specially built to solve these kind of needs, which is more adaptable to the variety of data that they're trying to master and to the scale of data that they're trying to master. So I hope that answers your question.
Sure. I hope Jiku, he's saying thank you. Abhijit has a question. How we can control duplication of data using AI?
Okay, so duplication, see, exists at various levels, right? Duplication, I think the best way is obviously to stop it at the source. But then to stop it at the source, you actually, while you are, you know, entering data, at that point itself, you have to keep a check and to, you know, flag off records which are looking like duplicates from what you already have in the system. So that is one. Then secondly, there has to be a periodic check within the organization by MDM techniques or other data matching techniques, where similar records are, you know, matched together and flagged back to the source systems. So they can update and they can make sure that they're not, you know, adding further records like that.
All right, thanks, Sonal. So 5 minutes left before we close the session. Audience, do you have any other question to ask Sonal? Sonal, do you have any closing thoughts?
No, I guess I just hope that, you know, people kind of had a good understanding of, you know, how AI can actually be applied to the data management practice. And if they have any, if you know, to all those who are attending, thank you so much for taking the time out on just post lunch and attending the session. Just shows, you know, what a great audience you are. So if you have any doubts or if you need any clarifications, I mean, just feel free to reach out to me personally. I'll try to answer them or through any of the NASSCOM channels. And I would also like to thank Ankita for, you know, helping me with this presentation and organizing everything so well.
Thank you so much, Sonal. Just one question, two more questions popped in and we have 4 minutes. Shall we take them?
Sure, absolutely.
There's one question by Pooja. She's saying, any techniques to identify the golden data?
For master data management, honestly, we've tried to see if, you know, AI can actually be used for MDM, for the golden record creation. But what I kind of feel is that golden record creation kind of falls into, you know, one of those problem areas where I specifically said, don't apply AI. Because the rules are very codified within the organization, right? How do you say that, you know, this source system is more trusted, or pick out this field from this source system, even though the other fields may be more updated recently? So it's a very business logic driven decision. So I think just building out the golden record through AI doesn't seem like the right problem to solve. But what I feel is that a lot of analysis, post-analysis of, you know, the drift on the golden record, how are the values shaping up, are we choosing one source system every time over the other, feedback on the rules and the, you know, on the choices. I think that to some extent can be automated through AI. We're kind of still working on that. So I don't have a very cohesive answer yet. But just stay tuned. We'll probably have another session on that then.
Sure. Thanks, Sonal. Gopalakrishnan has two questions. Number one, from where do you start the MDM journey?
So from where do you start the MDM journey is more about, I think, first is just identification of, you know, whether you really have a problem. So as I said, right, that organizations understand that, concatenating or unifying this data holds tremendous business value. So I think from the business standpoint, first, there has to be clarity and there has to be a buy-in, saying that they want to look at, you know, all these systems in whole and be ready to take that initiative.
So it has to be a mix of business and IT. IT provides the tools, but business has to be brought in and to be ready to say that they are actually open to, you know, this integration. And I think that's where the journey starts. The moment you say that, you know, I have piecemeal data, but within this piecemeal data, if I join data within my organization or from some reference sources through third party maybe or through suppliers, I can get a better view. If that buy-in is there, that's where the MDM journey actually starts.
Sure. Thank you so much, Sonal, for this enriching session. Really very pragmatic approach towards managing the agile master data management. Thank you for your input and efforts, Sonal. And to all the audience, I will meet all of you tomorrow at 2:30 with a session from our GTM series on emotional quotient, one simple secret for fulfillment and abundance in sales. There's one prerequisite. Please carry a pen and paper and preferably use a headphone for this super engaging session tomorrow. Thank you, Sonal. Thank you so much for your time. And as Sonal said in the beginning, that if there are more questions, if there are unanswered questions and you have more doubts, you can reach out to her or through her LinkedIn, or you can send questions to me. I can reshare it with her and we'll get back with all the answers. Thank you, Sonal. Thank you, everyone.
This is perfect. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Ankita. Thanks. Bye.